Morning, South Community Church. My name is Mark Simpson. I'm the youth pastor here at South Community Church. I have the honor and privilege to share this word from you today. We're going through a series right now called Questions. Last week we talked about what do you want? Jesus asking Bartimaeus, what does he want? A man that was blind. Today we're going to be asking a little bit of a different question. Jesus asked Peter the question, who do you say I am? But before we do all of that, before I go into my points and your discussions and all that, can we not play church this morning and just be real? Are you going to say okay to that? Another way to say amen. Okay, let's do it that way. What we want to do is before we jump into here is when there's expressed needs in the church, when I look at the early church, they would stop everything and they would fill those needs. They would say, hey, let's stop the song. Let's stop the scripture reading and let's go meet the need. And that's how the church really had great community and how it grew is because when you walked in, see, this is what, I'm going to jump into my word right now, but this is what the enemy does. He tries to attack the natural, and that's what he does. He goes after your bank account, your house, he attacks the natural, but what God protects is the supernatural, something that he can't even touch, something that he can't even put his finger on. And so he'll come looking for the church, look for a building, where we're the living stones and we are the church, And we can meet in any place, any location, and still be the church, regardless of an air conditioner or a roof or a door. You know what I'm saying? And so when we have needs as the church and we have things that stop us from fulfilling our purpose, I feel like we need to stop and we need to express our calling of what Christ wants to come. So this morning, I want to stop right now, and I'm sorry, camera people, but I'm going to come down here and pray for Manny, because my brother Manny needs healing in his body. And he's been going through stuff. I don't know if you know it or not, but this man is a man of God, this man that he gets up in the morning and he teaches the Start Here class, and he's dedicated and devoted. He serves as an elder. I mean, this man loves the church. Amen? Amen. All right. You got it that time. All right. And so we're going to pray for Manny. Because the Bible specifically says, hey, pray in my name and things will happen. Pray in my name and believe that who I am and as being Jesus Christ, I can absolutely change the natural or the supernatural. Because I went to the cross, I have the keys of death, and I have brought the church freedom. So we're going to pray. If you would, if you feel comfortable, extend your hand to Manny. And I'm just going to pray for my brother right now because I love you, okay? All right. Heavenly Father God, you're really in love with us, God. So much, Father God. And I know that you love our brother Manny. And I know, Lord, that you have given him appointment after appointment after appointment, God. And you have walked with him and you have grown his faith. I believe that this man has this spiritual gift of faith. That he can see the storm coming for him, God. And he's going to stand firm. He's been a man that has went from not being able to walk to walk. He's been a man that stood on the doorstep of death and said, I have my Savior. Come if you will, but I will still serve him. And he is with us today. I thank you, Lord, that you are a God that loves us so much that you would send your son Jesus. And it's by and through his mighty name that I pray for Manny right now, Father God. That as a church, Lord, we love him and we know that you're using him, God. I pray that you would continue the ministry that flows out of this man's life. I pray, Father God, that the words that come out of his mouth would be your words, God, that would be able to speak life into death situations. I thank you, Lord, that this is a man that has given his life to serve and honor you, a man that was running away, but now he's running towards you, Father God. I thank you, Lord, that you have appointed time just as today to express your love to Manny. We thank you for our church. We thank you for Manny, the living stone of South Community Church. And we pray all these things in the cornerstone of who we believe, Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. In his mighty name we pray, amen. 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 Love you, brother. And we just pray and close this thing out. We'll see you later. No, I'm just... I mean, that's, if we want to call ourselves a community church, we just got to be real sometimes, you know? It's not about the sit down, stand up. It's not about, you know, we got to get through the steps. It's about seeing needs and expressing those things. And so Jesus was with his disciples. We're going to be in Matthew today, Matthew 16. And he was letting the disciples follow him, letting them see him, letting him get a glimpse of eternity. And it was in Matthew 16 that he finally stops the conversation. And it wasn't a sign, and it wasn't a healing, and it wasn't, you know, someone that was lame getting up to walk. It was just a conversation. And he was going to be in this moment and show and give revelation to his disciples. And we're in Matthew 16, starting in 13. And so we often look at Jesus, and we say his name now is Jesus Christ, right? A lot of us use it like a last name, you know, last name is C. No, it's not. That is his title. And it means the anointed one. It means that Jesus, and a lot of in his ministry, he would hold off on his disciples saying, hey, don't call me the Messiah yet, because it's not my appointed time. Because once you release that word, there are things that will come after that word. Persecution. And Jesus wasn't a fearful man. He was actually just divinely inspired by God, following the will of the Father, knowing when was the appointed time to release the clarification of his presence. I'm Jesus of Nazareth. But at this point in Matthew 16, he shows them exactly who he was. I'm Jesus the Messiah. I'm Jesus the Christ. And we get Messiah from the Hebrew, we get Christ from the Greek, and it just means the anointed one. Jesus was the anointed one to change every single thing. Where Adam was the one that fell away and let sin come into the world, being the one man that also gave us an inheritance of sin, Jesus would be the anointed one to bring us back into relationship and pay for every single sin of our lives. And that's how it would happen. Simple as that. So Jesus Christ, the anointed one, it's a title that we often use, and we say it and it comes out of our mouth, and sometimes we curse with it, and sometimes we speak the name in vain, and it is never meant to do anything like that. It is meant to be a blessing. So when we pray for a brother, we know that we have power in our words, that we're not praying through Mark. You wouldn't get nowhere if you prayed through Mark. But we pray through Jesus in the power of his name because he has shown us the way. So I'm going to be in Matthew 16, verse 13. Now, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he was asking his disciples, who do you say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets. He said to them, but who do you yourselves say that I am? And then my boy Simon Peter, he's that guy in the crew that always likes to speak up. I'm about to go get this apple from the teacher right now. I'm going to show you guys. Watch this. But really, it wasn't Simon Peter. If we read on, God was showing him and revealing something on the inside to Simon Peter. And so he's going to speak up and give the greatest truthful answer that he has probably ever spoken in his life. He says, with confidence, I can just imagine. I can imagine like they're all sitting around the fire, and he stands up and maybe points at them. He says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. It's exactly who you are. And can you imagine the face that Jesus had right after that? Like going from a moment where he was sitting in front of Lazarus' tomb and crying because they weren't getting who he was and the power that he had, to actually seeing one of the closest disciples finally get it and say it, being revealed by God. I just imagine Jesus with the biggest smile on his face. The first question for you guys to talk about together is this question. Do you believe he is the Christ, the Son of the living God? And then why? Why do you believe what you believe? All right, let's talk about it.
Yeah.
All right. So the bottom line is basically this today, what you need to take away is, who do you say Jesus is? Because when you can answer that question and have confidence behind it, things just change around you. You understand that you have faith in the risen Savior. You understand that your life has been changed. The dead things have become new. There was a 7-year-old little boy that used to sit behind his dad who did the audio channel thing that Michael's doing back there, soundboard. And every single Sunday, the pastor at Mount Olive Baptist Church in Crossett, Arkansas, would give an altar call. And this little boy, being me, would stand up like wanting to go down, and then I would get the look like, you ain't ready for that, and then I would sit back down. But one Sunday, something said, I don't know if it was like the rebellious, like, I love Jesus, I'm gonna do this today. I stood up, I didn't even look at my dad, and I just went straight for the pastor. I could just feel the eyes in the back of my head. And I went down and I walked down, and we were in the balcony. And so the balcony exited when you came down the stairs right on the front of the stage. And so I came all, bloop, 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 7-year-old Mark, popping down. And then there was like stairs right up here, and he would just wait up there for you. And so I went right on down, and the pastor, I was like, oh, this is the moment. He's going to encourage me in the faith. He's going to say, well done, Mark. Okay, let's talk about Christ. Let's talk about what you believe. And he looks at me in my face with a smile and says, did you talk to your parents about this? I said, come on, man, in my mind. I said, this is my decision. Love Jesus. I'm going to love him. I'm going to express my faith. And it was weeks later that, you know, the old Baptist baptismal, like behind the choir, you know, I was wearing the gown, and then he dunked me in the water. I got baptized. And like, that was the start of my faith. But did I understand all of it? No. You don't have to understand the complete and total divine nature of who Christ was as God and as a physical being, as man, to enter and know this faith that he is the risen Lord. See, the gospel is very simple to understand. We can't get past that. But what we try to do sometimes as adults is we complicate it. We complicate it to where it's almost unshareable because we get confused. There was a man that loved you so much that he wanted to die for your sins, those sins that you could repay, and because he died for them and you believed in them and professed it by faith, that you now have everlasting life. And you belong to a family called the kingdom of heaven now. Like, 7-year-old Mark gets that. Right now, the gospel is being sent out to your children in kids' ministry. That's our one goal. It's not a craft. It's not a song. It's for them to understand that truth. But what happens after that is what we're going to talk about today, is that after we have that moment of salvation, we have this walk that proceeds out of it, that reflects back to that moment. If you could go back right now to the person you were when you declared Christ for the very first time as your Lord and Savior, would that person looking at you right now be proud or be a little sad? Do we ask ourselves that question? Would that person be like, oh my goodness, you're doing it. You're running with this faith that you have. Or is it just a title? Yeah, I'm a Christian. Jesus wanted Peter to know exactly who he was, because Peter had not yet seen what was going to happen. His disciples, his own disciples were going to deny him, not even be there at the moment of his crucifixion. So I get it. Belief sometimes comes with a stress. But the question we always have to ask ourselves every single day is, who do I say Jesus is? Because that should be reflected in your life. Who you say Jesus is should be reflected in your words and your actions and your character and your integrity. Because if it's not there, it's showing people a whole nother thing. You know what I'm saying? Because if you give yourself the title, I'm a Christian, but I'm like the guy that everyone hates at work, what does that mean? You know? Like, you are a witness to the kingdom of heaven. Peter was a witness, and he would go and die for this, that others would know about Christ and what he did for them. It says in 17, and Jesus said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, son of Jonah, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." That begs the question, what is revealed is then hidden. The kingdom of heaven is hidden, and it is our responsibility to show people the kingdom of heaven. Who do you say Jesus is? A person that is a non-believer says, yeah, I know of a man. People talk about him all the time, historical figure, a man that lived. There's tons of documents that document his date, his death. We take his death and we center our time around it. I mean, his name is everywhere. But not everyone believes that he is the risen Lord. The Muslims believe in Jesus, but they don't believe in him as the Son of God, the risen Savior. They believe that he's a prophet. But you have to understand, who do you say Jesus is? Do you say he is the Son of the living God? Can I point to fruit in your life that would show me that? Who do you say Jesus is? He says this, "And I say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it." That should encourage you. The church has been given power by Jesus. And he tells Peter this, and he says, be encouraged that, yeah, you're going to go through some things, but the gates of Hades won't even prevail against the church. It says in 19, "I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven." Then he gave the disciples strict orders that they were to tell no one that he was the Christ. You see, he was giving Peter a revelation. He was basically giving them responsibility and authority and the supernatural power to lead the church. After I go, Holy Spirit will come and you're going to lead the church. You're going to take the keys, and the keys represent something. The keys aren't the access. The keys give you the access. Jesus Christ was going to be the key. Peter wasn't going to be the way that we get to heaven. He was going to know about the key that would unlock eternity. And that was the knowledge of who Jesus is and was and will be. And so as the church, we're given the key. And it looks like this. This is the key that will help loosen and bind things here on earth. We will loosen people that have been bound by sin and feel like they can never change and feel like they have to be ashamed their whole life and feel like they have nothing to live for. We will loosen them up and let them be free in the kingdom of heaven by understanding who Jesus is. This is the key. This is the key that he was telling Peter to. Jesus told him that, hey, I'm the Word of God. And none of the words of God will return void. If you believe in it, if you believe in this, you will be saved. That was the key. But we, as the church, sometimes hold the key and it just dangles on our keychain. And we kind of like, it's one of those keys on our keychain. Like, do you have keys on your keychain right now that you don't even know what they go to? Yeah, I got three of them. I still haven't figured it out. I want to throw them away, but who throws away keys, right? Got to figure it out. I've been carrying this extra thing around all the time. But sometimes that's what we do, you know? We'll give platitudes to people and say, oh, it's going to be all right, you know. It's going to be okay. Just struggle through it, you know. But we have the key dangling on our keychain. Like, I know you're going through a divorce right now. It's tough, but keep going. You know, like, what? How does that help them? Keep going? No, we have the key to bring healing. We have the key to bring knowledge. We have the key to bring wisdom. We have the key to help someone start their faith. And it's not us. We're just the bearers, like we carry it, like Peter did for his faith. He carried this into the world with the other disciples. You are a direct descendant of this key that Peter held, because after disciple, after disciple, after disciple, after disciple, after disciple, it came to Sarah, and Sarah believed it. And now she's singing praise and worship songs about it. The key means that you have been granted access to something hidden. But God wants it revealed to you. That is who he is. He wants it to be known. He starts to understand that Jesus, his life, the truth of who he was marked for death. That was the reason that he was here. Your declaration of faith, it is followed by three decisions. I'm going to give you some spiritual vitamin D today. I went to the doctor like about a month ago, and I got a physical. Haven't done one of those in about 3 years. He says, Mark, you're doing great, but you're vitamin D deficient. I'm like, what does that mean? He's like, I don't know. Here you go. Take it. You know, he knows what he's talking about, but he just told me to take this vitamin D, 50,000, blah, 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 and I took it wrong because I was supposed to take it every week, and I took it every month, you know? And I still have a bunch of these pills. I'm supposed to take them. And vitamin D, I guess, is just when you go outside, your body makes vitamin D, and it makes you feel better. It's actually a benefit of being active. Anyways, so it's okay. I'll get there. Here's some vitamin D for you. All right. Three decisions that come after your declaration of faith. The first decision is this. You need to decide that you're going to dedicate. You're going to dedicate. I dedicate myself to this new life. I will start to live for Christ. You have declared your faith, and now you need to dedicate your life. Okay? Jesus came as you were, full of sin, what you have done, and said, you can't earn your way into heaven. It's through my blood. It's through the cross of what I've done, and it's me raising up on the third day again, and I'm going to give you salvation. But now your part is to start working to bear some fruit. Show people that the salvation is there through the fruit. And it starts with dedicating your life. What are you going to do with this time that I've been given to you? Dedicate. The second D is devotion. I will spend time with God in this relationship. I will actively pursue him in what we do. I will talk to him. I will pray to him. I will read his word. I will be devoted like it's a relationship, not a transaction, a relationship. I will talk to him at all points of the day, not just morning and night and over meals, all points of the day. I will talk to him like he's sitting right there next to me because he is. And I will go to him first about everything and anything. This week, I found a snake in my shoe. Y'all, this happened. I am not lying. Thursday morning, I got up and I put on my shoe. Both of them, because I wear two, and put my foot in, and I felt something in there. I'll be real with you, I thought it was a leaf. It was a leaf, you know? So, but I kept walking, I was like, that's gone now. So I went to work. 3 hours later, I'm leaving the building, going into my car. I feel it again. I'm like, and I'm like, okay, only thing I gotta do is either I keep feeling it all day or I take off my shoe. So I take off my shoe. I take off my shoe and I pick it up like this. And from the toe of the shoe to the heel drops down a snake. And I'm like, no! And I threw it on the floor. Get behind me, Satan! You know, I was like, no, this is, I was like, in my mind, I was like, this is not happening. And it's like slithering on my floorboard of my car. What's going to my mind next? I got to get out of the car. Because if it goes somewhere in this car, I'm lighting it on fire. It's car's gone. Got to tell my work, hey, I'm sorry about this car that y'all got me. But there was a snake in it. I got it taken care of. Call the insurance people. So I pick up my floorboard, pull it out, and let the snake go. So somewhere in the parking lot of St. John is a snake slithering around. That likes warm leather shoes. Yeah. Broken Arrow campus. That's okay. It's not the main one. Yeah. But I can remember screaming in my head, no, but all I said after that was like, God, help me. And then you better believe I was checking every part of my foot, like, where's the snake bite? Where's the snake bite? Where's the snake bite? And there was no snake bite there. And then I just laughed. I was like, God, this is hilarious. I don't need illustration like this for Sundays. Let's do some other stuff. And he was the first person I told. Like, this is, well, he saw it, obviously. But then I blew up everyone else. Like, check this out, check this out, check this out, check this out. And I heard, no, no way, more information, all this other stuff. Devotion. It needs to be a relationship, guys. It needs to be someone that you, It's not a last resort. It's not a when problems pop up. It needs to be just good and bad. Everything needs to be shared. All right, the third D. You get some vitamin D. Is discipleship. If you understand who Jesus is, if you declare him by faith who he is, and you're dedicated to him, and you're devoted to him, discipleship is obvious. Why wouldn't you share this with more people? This life-saving relationship that you have, why wouldn't it go out from who you are and tell other people about it? You have to share. We're commanded to share. We're commanded to love thy neighbor as yourself, and we're dedicated to do that. See, my family takes care of me. That was my dad over there. God bless him. Just make sure he didn't hit his head. All right. Way to go, Chris. All right. Who do you say Jesus is? John 6:3-8. Go there with me. This is what Jesus was meant to do. It says this. Try to summarize. I'm sorry. This is what it says. It says in verse 8. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. This is your next question. It's try to summarize Jesus' mission in one sentence. Just try to summarize it. What was he meant to do? Try to summarize it in one sentence. If you guys have your discussion question, go for it. I might only give you 3 minutes on this, by the way. It's kind of easy. Hey, and if you're watching online, try to put your one sentence in the text and see if we can read it, and we'll talk about it. Thank you. All right, I'm going to cut you guys short in 30 seconds. All right. Your second fill-in is this. Jesus Christ wanted to reveal the will of the Father, why he was sent. And we see that. And we see that when he says that in John 6:38. He says, "For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me." That's why he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane. That's why he spends that time when he's going in, like as we celebrate Passover coming up, we celebrate Palm Sunday coming up. That's why he asked that question, like, "Is this something, Father, that you can take away from me?" Because he was sent to do the will of the Father. He says, "No, but it's thy will be done, not my own." Jesus, though, continues in verse 21. It says this, "From that time, Jesus began to point out to disciples that it was necessary for him to go to Jerusalem and to suffer many things from the elders, chief priests, and scribes, and to be killed and to be raised up on the third day." He tells them this. He says, "Let me reveal the plan. Now that you know who I am, the Messiah, this is the plan moving forward. I'm going to go and die. I'm going to go and die so something may live, and that is you." And he says this, and yet, in verse 22, something happens. Peter looked or took him aside and began to rebuke him. Peter takes him aside from all the other disciples and says, "Don't say that. We don't want you to die. We need you to live." He was speaking to something he didn't even know. If you don't live, how can we share the message? It's a lot easier, Jesus, to share the message if I can just point to you or bring people to you and show them the Messiah. Don't die. And Jesus, it kind of sets Jesus off. Because Peter says, "God forbid it, Lord. This shall never happen to you." Peter doesn't know what he just did. He tries to put a plan in place that is in no way connected to God's will. And we do this sometimes. We try to create our own path that is not connected to the will of the Father. You want to know the will of the Father? Be devoted to him. Be dedicated, devoted, and making disciples. You will know the will of the Father. Peter, a man that stood right next to Jesus, comes up with this plan, his own plan, says, "No, let's do it this way." And this is Jesus' response. But he turned back and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are not setting your mind on God's purposes, but men's." He looks at Peter and rebukes what the enemy is trying to do with this statement. See, God is set on kingdom things. He's set on the supernatural to bring the kingdom of heaven, bring citizenship to the people walking on this earth. The enemy is trying to go the opposite way, to work in the natural and all the things that we see and all the decay and the sadness and the sickness and everything like that, trying to bring down those who would call on hope in Christ, to let them focus on that. And right then and there, Jesus says, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block for the purposes of God. You are a stumbling block for the will of my Father, who I have set up my whole life to do. You're not going to ruin this for me by trying to come up with your own plan." I could just see Peter with his eyes wide open like, "Where's Satan at? I'll punch him right in the face," you know? But this shows us two ways. The will of the Father, who wants to bring you into the citizenship of heaven, and the will of the enemy, that wants to twist, contort, and confuse you to walk away. The third fill-in is that we are called to set on our minds. We are called to set our minds on God's purposes. We need to be constantly aware, like, "God, what is your purpose for me in this? God, what is your purpose for me at this job? God, what is your purpose for me in this household? God, what is your purpose for me at this school? God, what is your purpose for me as I travel to this city, or as I move to this city, or as I find this church?" Like, we need to be asking that question constantly
So we know that we're not in our own will, but is in his will. And let me talk to the dads in here. I get this, because when you get home from work and you pull up and you park your car and you're about to go in, and you know those kids want your attention. You know those kids, they want you to spend time with them. But you have your purpose. I got to get in there. I'm going to be a little tired. I've got to change. Whatever you got to do after you get home from work. And you have your purposes. But God has his purposes too. It literally takes me in the car. I have to set out in my mind, God, I need to have energy when I go into this household. Because I didn't work all day that my kids would get the leftovers. I didn't work all day and provide a house and provide food and electricity so my kids would get a glimpse of who daddy is. I didn't do all of this that would just be wiped away. I don't care about that. I care about my kids and the relationship with them. If you boil down the day, that is what I care about. But what we do is we get fixed on our own purposes. I got to go here. I got to do this. I got to do this. You know, that thing's leaking and that thing's not working. Like, dad's got to do, you know? But you have to hone in your mind and say, God, you have given me purpose in this household to show my wife what a loving husband looks like, to love her as the church, to show my kids and give them the attention, the affection that they deserve to be the father figure that points to you. God will show you those purposes if you ask. Absolutely, he will. Jesus was set on a course of death that would bring life to those who believed in his name. He was set on this course. He was laser focused. He didn't have time to sit down with Peter and talk about his statement versus his statement. He said, no, get behind me, Satan. You're just a stumbling block. Let's keep moving. It goes on in verse 24. It says, then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone wants to come after me, he must deny himself. We're putting action. Watch this. We're putting action now after our faith. Those who call in the name of Christ have action that bears fruit, and this is part of it. You can't miss this. If anyone wants to come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. At the end of your life, if you will say, it was all about Jesus, you will have life. At the end of your life, if you have been confused and never called on the name of Jesus and have lived your life your way for your will, you will have the life that you have created, but you really won't have life. And this is the gospel. Jesus doesn't show us any other way. He is the way, the truth, and the life. There is no other way to God other than Jesus. Do you hear that today? That's the only way. The culture and the world, they're going to want to make amends to that statement, that make everything seem okay. Everything is not okay. This world needs a Savior that needs to know it needs a Savior. It's not okay. This is what we're given. This is the charge at the end of the sermon, okay? God has given each and every one of you three things to make this happen, to manifest in your life. If you're dedicated, devoted, and making disciples, he's going to equip you for this. This is what one of the big functions of the church is, to equip you for the equipping of other saints, other people would believe. God has given you tools. A tool is your car. That doesn't have snakes in it. Amen. Another tool is your job, your income, your business, the things that God has blessed you with. He has given you tools to use. Another thing is places, locations, places that I can't access. You know, I can't go into the place work of Joel. They would kick me out of there. I cannot go into the place work of Matt. They would, like, this guy can't turn. Like, what are you doing here? Get out of here. Like, I can't go into the places that you can go into. If you want to share the gospel, it's not your requirement to call me and have me show up and show your friends and your employees who I am, and then I'll share the gospel. That is exactly what Peter was trying to do. He was saying, don't die. I want to show you to people. Jesus was saying, no, you need to be me. You need to be my hands and my feet. You need to show them the gospel. So we're given places that no one else can access. I can't access the drive-thru at Starbucks like Joel can. Man, that guy talks to more people in a day than I probably ever would. You know? Another thing he gives us is gifts and talents. And this is promised by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit grows in us fruit, right? But he also gives us gifts that are in the Bible that tells us that, hey, you're going to have a spirit of knowledge. I know you have the gift of faith. I know it's there. You have wisdom and knowledge, tongues and prophecy. All of those things are in the Bible. Don't skip over them because they're there waiting for you to equip you with these other things, the tools and the places. And once you're equipped, you need to stride in boldness to help those that are living in darkness. Our mission this year is to each one of us to reach one. Start with the one. And for parents, this starts in the home. What kind of, like, you can go out and make all the disciples in the world, but if your home is falling apart, what's that about? No, it starts in the home. And after the home is established and founded on the rock, move. Go out and open your eyes and put your mind on God's purposes. God, who are you going to be showing me today at work? God, who are you going to be showing to me today at lunch? Who do I need to talk to, God? And believe that it's not you. The easier it becomes is when you know it's not you. Holy Spirit, this is your time. I'm checking in. Take over. You know, it's like put the word in your heart and go. There's people that are running the race backwards. We're running towards Jesus, and you're seeing runners go the opposite way. And how are we okay with that? How are you okay with the person at work that you know is so sad? You are the person with that awareness that God just unlocked to say, you need to be me in that situation to go help them. You need to understand, be empathetic, help them, and when they ask the question, you need to give them the key. I know this man named Jesus. I was in situations just like you, and he saved me. He did things I knew I could never do, and he saved me. Can I tell you about him? Those conversations won't happen if you don't look for them. No one just walks up, hey, bloop, can you tell me about Jesus? That doesn't happen, you know? Most of the time, people are upset if you bump into them. That is not a good way to evangelize the gospel. I'm going to go bump into all the people at the mall, and then when I drop our stuff, I'll pick up their stuff and tell them about Jesus. It doesn't work that way. I mean, you can try it, but record it, though. I love you guys. And I know that God has appointed you to a time with the tools, the places that you will go, and these gifts. And he's not trying to waste these things. He's wanting to use them. He's trying to encourage you through the church to find the person that should be sitting right here. This is your neighbor that's going through a divorce. This is your uncle that has cancer. Lord, you know you need them. This right over here, this is that old man that lives in your neighborhood that no one talks to, that you see walking his dog every single day almost, and no one talks to him. Guys, there's people all around you that need this message. And now that you have it, you're commanded to go. There could be some of you in here that you've got a calling on your life. You're not even supposed to be in this city. And you've waited and delayed on it. What would a life look like if you gave it fully to God? That was a life that you want. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you, Lord. We thank you, God, for moments like these where we are stretched and exposed by the gospel about things that we need. And I pray, Father God, for those, first and foremost, those in here that don't believe in the name of Jesus, that if I would ask them the question, who do you say Jesus is? That they would have the faith today to say, I believe for the first time that he is the risen Lord, that he died on the cross for my sins, that I'm saved, and that I was a wretched person, but this amazing saved me, has saved me and changed me, and he's renewing me. I pray that if that is you in here today, come find me after service, because I'm going to pray with you. I won't ask you if you talk to your parents about this. I will ask you about how we can cultivate this relationship now, because you have expressed your faith, but now we need to dedicate your life, be devoted to Him, and make disciples out of it. And I pray right now, Father God, for these people in here, Father. I pray for an awakening of their mind, knowing that they need to live out their life reflecting who your Son is and what He did for us. We love you, Lord, and pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. But then you stepped right in and showed me grace. You found me.